There will be a few theorems in this section, and let's prove the first one, the breakpoint theorem. First, let's define the notions of adjacencies and breakpoints looking at this permutation. Plus 3 and plus 4 are arranged in the right order, in the same order they are arranged in the identity permutation. Let's call it an adjacency. Plus 4 and plus 5, the same story. Plus 5 and minus 12 is definitely out of order. And certainly there should be a breakpoint that cuts between them. So there should be a reversal with one of its endpoints between plus 5 and minus 12, because otherwise we will never be able to transform this permutation into the identity permutation. Minus 12, minus 8, also breakpoint. This is an interesting case. Minus 8 and minus 7. It's not plus 7 and plus 8 as we want to see in the identity permutation, but maybe there will be a reversal that contains both minus 8 and minus 7, and then after reversing, they will turn into perfect orientation and will correspond to the case plus 7 and plus 8, and that's why we say minus 8 and minus 7 are in order, despite being converted. Minus 7, minus 6, the same story. Minus 6 plus 1 is definitely a breakpoint. Adjacency, breakpoint. This is also a breakpoint. Think about why it is a breakpoint. Again, breakpoint, breakpoint, and finally adjacency. Have we done? Not quite yet, because there are two more implicit elements of this permutation, 0 and n plus 1, that describes the start and end of this permutation. And 0 and plus 3 is a breakpoint because 0 should not be next to plus 3, it should be next to plus 1. And plus 14 plus 15 is adjacency. So after we define adjacencies and breakpoints, clearly number of adjacencies plus number of breakpoints in the permutation equals to length of the permutation plus 1. And before we go further, I want to ask you the question, what is the number of breakpoints in the identity permutation, plus 1, plus 2, plus n? Of course, this permutation has no breakpoints, 0, which means that sorting by reversal is essentially breakpoint elimination. Let's see how it works. So let's start from the initial permutation that has 6 breakpoints. We move next. There are only 4 breakpoints left. We move left, again, 4 breakpoints left. We move further, 2 breakpoints. And finally, in the identity permutation, 0 breakpoints, which means that every sorting by reversal should reduce the number of breakpoints from 6 to 0 in this case. We don't know what sequence of reversal is minimal, but we know that each of them will result in reduction of the number of breakpoints to 0. Next question, how many breakpoints can be eliminated by a single reversal? Well, the answer to this question is simple. Reversal has two ends, and nothing happens with breakpoints on the left and on the right of this endpoint. Also, every breakpoint that existed within this interval will remain the breakpoint. And therefore, the only breakpoints that can be affected by reversals are the two breakpoints on the end of the reversals. And since at every step the number of breakpoints can be reduced by at most 2, we have the breakpoint theorem. Reversal distance should be larger or equal than the number of breakpoints over. And it also immediately suggests a new greedy algorithm, and probably better greedy algorithm, for sorting by reversal. Indeed, the only thing we need to do to sort a permutation optimally is to reduce the number of breakpoints by 2 at every step. Let's look at our sequence of sorting by reversals. And we see that at this step, we did something silly. We were supposed to be reducing the number of breakpoints, but the number of, and by 2 at every step, but the number of breakpoints actually has not even reduced at this reversal. Maybe we should have chosen another reversal that would reduce the number of breakpoints by 2, but you can check that there is no such reversal. And in fact, there are permutations for which there are no reversal reducing number of breakpoints even by 1, which means whatever you do, the number of breakpoints remains the same. And that's why it turned out that the algorithms for sorting by reversals are actually quite complex. Even if I had an hour or two of time one-on-one with you, I wouldn't be able to explain all intricacies of the polynomial algorithms for sorting by reversals. And that's why I will switch from the problem of sorting by reversal to a different, seemingly even more difficult problem of finding rearrangements and optimal sorting by of multi-chromosomal genomes.